Finally, we come to a section in which we would like to complete the proofs of various statements that we have made in this chapter and postpone their proofs. So let us take them one by one, the proofs of several statements. The very first thing about homotopy, it should remind you of Poincaré's lemma in differential topology, if you have studied it. Indeed, people got the idea from there, and now they have made it completely generalized. So let us first concentrate on singular homology, okay, and then the homotopy axiom will be proved by proving the lemma 3.7, in which we promise that we will construct the prism operator. This prism operator is going to be the homotopy between eta 1 and eta 2. So this is going to be a map from sq to sq plus 1 cross sq of x to sq plus 1 of x cross I, and the relative version also. Okay, eta naught and eta 1 are inclusion maps of x in x cross 0 and x cross 1, and these are the maps which are induced at the level of chain level. And this h, we promised that it will be functorial. In a way, by demanding that it should be functorial, actually helps us in construction of H itself. So what is the functoriality here? Suppose you have a continuous function of the pairs from XA to YB, any continuous function, then H from XA to S of X cross I, similarly the H from YB to S of Y cross B, they should be compatible under this alpha. Alpha is here. Obviously, what I have to take here is alpha cross identity. Identity factor on the interval. Interval factor, it's identity, alpha cross I. Take alpha cross identity star here. So this diagram must be commutative. Okay. So this is what we demand, though it is not, it won't have been necessary for us to prove the homotopy invariance. But then, if sigma is a singular n-simplex, a singular n-simplex can be thought of as a map from delta n to x. Okay, so that takes the place of alpha here, and then what we get is we would get H of sigma, H, okay, H composite sigma, sigma is any same thing as H of alpha star, where alpha is sigma, sigma star, would be equal to alpha composite identity is alpha is sigma, sigma cross identity star of H. Okay, sigma cross identity star of H, operating on the identity map here. Take the identity element in delta S dot of delta N. Okay. In fact, Sn of delta N, the identity map from delta N to delta N is one of the generators there. On that, it should have this property. So this gives us idea that it is enough to define this H sigma, H of sigma, not for arbitrary sigma, but for just xi n. Suppose you have defined it for xi n, then for arbitrary sigma, H of sigma must be given by this formula. Okay, by the functoriality. therefore, our task of defining H sigma, see, H has to be defined on the whole of S dot, but then it has to be linear, and so it is enough to define it on the generators. What are the generators? Generators are arbitrary, simple shell, arbitrary continuous maps from delta n to x. Even that is not necessary. Just define it for each delta n. For each n, you define it only on xi n. Okay, where xi n is the identity map of mod delta n to delta n. It's a continuous map. So if you define for each n H of xi n, then we are done. Then I will take this as a formula for H sigma, then extend it linearly, that will be there. Of course, we have to verify that it's a chain homotopy. So what is the property that will make it chain homotopy? So that I can define it just by H of xi n. So that is our next goal, analyzing this one. So the demand for H is that eta 1 star sigma, eta naught star sigma must be equal to H of daba sigma plus daba of H sigma. So this is the meaning of that H is chain homotopy between eta 1 and eta naught. For every sigma, if it is true, then it will be true for every chain. Okay. So this is what we want. But then by functoriality, if we can manage to have it only on xi n, then we are done. Because once 33 is true, I can take sigma star of these things. For sigma, if you put say xi n is sigma, sigma can be thought of as sigma star of xi n. Okay, and then use this property for xi n, and then you'll get the property for sigma. So we can apply simply sigma cross identity star to both sides of 33 to get 32. So our task is to define xi n, H of xi n, so that it satisfies this 33. All right. Now I have to recall the prism construction. After all, it's going to be the prism operator. This was elaborately introduced in part one, but now I will have to do it the way I want it right now here. Okay. So in delta n cross I or I cross delta n, whichever one you want to use, you can use that. So here I have just taken delta n cross I. Let B top I denote EI cross 0. Remember, even E naught, even E2, En are the vertices of delta n. So for delta n cross I, you have EI comma 0 at the zeroth level, and C top I is EI comma 1. The same thing at the level 1. Okay. So similarly, you can take the barycenter of delta n, place it at the level half. Let us have a notation for that gamma n. For each n, I am going to do this, okay? The barycenter of delta n, okay, take at the level half inside delta n cross I and put it as gamma n. Okay, so just for suppose this is delta naught, then delta naught cross I is this one, okay? This will be your B naught, and this will be C naught, and this will be gamma naught. Now here in this one, this is delta 1, this is delta 1 cross I, so this is B naught and this is B1, C naught and C1. This will be gamma naught and this will be gamma 1. No, this point is not given a name in this one because it's the other way. This you can think of delta naught, this also delta naught, this gamma copy of delta naught. Gamma 1 will be here. So that is the charm here. So similarly for delta 3 also and delta 2 also, you can do that. What you have to do is inductively, you first inductively define for each point cross I, and I mean vertex cross I, and then edge cross I, okay, and then delta 2 cross I, and so on. So edge cross I, when you define, remember you are not going to divide the bottom face and the top face. You are only going to divide the vertical things, cross I, at the centers, at all the centers like this. And then you take another center here and then join them, cone construction. Okay, so this is the prism construction. All right, for any simplicial complex K, if sigma from delta n to K is a simplicial map, sigma equal to EI equal to VI, then we shall denote sigma by just V naught, V1, Vn. So this notation also we have introduced earlier. Okay, for this for a simplicial map. If X belongs to mod S, namely S is a simplex, where S contains this entire sigma of delta n, okay, this may be a subcomplex, then it may not be a subcomplex. Sigma could be any simplex also. Okay, sigma is a simplicial map, then we have this notation, but later on we will have this, but this notation is not available, no? So then X sigma is just the linear extension of V naught, V1, Vn with X, namely the so I have to describe what this means. X sigma on E naught, the first one will be X now, then V naught will be image of E1, V1 will be image of E2, Vi minus 1 will be image of Ei. Okay, by shifting. So you have this notation. All right. And extend it linearly over all the simplicial chains. So if rho is summation nj sigma j, is a singular n chain with support of sigma contained inside mod S. Okay. Then for any X belong to mod S, it makes sense to talk about X rho, namely summation nj, X sigma j. So X sigma j is a singular n plus 1 chain. This makes sense. All that I have to do is send X to E naught and the rest of them shift it. Take the delta 2 phase, delta naught phase of that, and there you define sigma j. So that is the meaning of this. Okay, omit delta naught, then you have delta 1, delta, sorry, omit E naught, then you have E1, E2, En. That will be a copy of your delta n, one lower dimension. There you take sigma j. So this will be, if X is a, if sigma is an n simplex, this one will be n plus 1 simplex, singular simplex. Okay. So now the definition of H is completed by induction again. The first thing is xi of this H of xi naught is gamma naught extended C naught minus B naught. So this is what I am doing here. C naught minus B naught, then extend it by gamma naught. So C naught minus B naught is a zero chain. Whereas the H of xi naught will be a one chain. What is that one chain? It is this to this one, sorry, this to this one up. The gamma naught to C naught minus gamma 1 to C1. Okay, so if it is like this, gamma 1 to C1 will be like this, sorry, gamma 1 to B naught will be like this, minus of that will be like this. So it will be this, this, all the way. If you put an arrow here upward, arrow here upward will be going up like that. Okay, so that is the meaning of this definition here. Gamma naught of C naught, gamma naught is in the center, C naught is there, so you go up. Gamma naught is center, B naught, you are coming down, but there is a minus sign, so you are going up again. Okay, so that is your one chain H of xi naught. Check that it satisfies 33 on S naught. You have to look at this one, right? H of Daba Huzayan. What is Daba Huzayan? There is nothing there. Okay, Xi naught, there is nothing. But Daba of H of Zion is there. What is that? The boundary of H of Zion will be C naught minus B naught. Right? C naught minus B naught, when you omit gamma naught, but when you keep gamma naught, there is nothing. So it is C naught minus B naught, which is just restriction of eta 1. The zero cell taking eta 1, it is B naught, C naught, and zero cell at eta naught level is B naught. This is a binary definition. So B naught, C naught minus B naught is C naught minus B naught. This part is zero. The boundary of H of xi n, boundary of this one, you omit this one to get the first C naught minus B naught. Then you keep this one and omit this one, there's empty set. So that those things are zero. Or C naught, again gamma minus gamma naught, you get, that will cancel out. Okay, so this is satisfied. Now, inductively assume that you have defined H of xi r for r less than or equal to minus 1, so that it satisfies 33. Then H will be defined on SR, r less than or equal to minus 1, by only defining H of xi r. Sorry. H of xi n now, okay, for r else n you have defined. Now you want to define it for h n. The moment you have defined H of xi r, h is defined on all of s r. You have to remember that. Once it is defined xi r, it is defined for all sigma in there, so it is linearly defined for all the entire chains there. So we have already defined it for SR, R less than or equal to minus 1. Now we want to define it for SN. Okay. What do we do? We have defined for xi n. So H of xi n, you define it as gamma n of C naught C1 C1 at the top. Okay. And minus B naught B1 Bn at the bottom. So this is precisely eta 1 minus eta 2 of xi n. Okay. That is why you have taken that. Minus H of boundary of xi n. Boundary of xi n is an n minus 1 chain. So there H is already defined. So I can take H of that. You delete that part. Okay. So that is a troublemaking thing. You delete that one. So by induction again, first of all, boundary of H of boundary of xi n is boundary of H of boundary of xi n, I what I am thinking, okay, is eta 1 star of boundary of xi n minus eta naught star of boundary of xi n minus H of H composite xi star boundary square of xi n. Okay, so that is equal to boundary of its whole thing, namely eta 1 star of xi n and eta naught star of xi n. So that is boundary of C naught C1 C1 minus B naught B1 Bn. Okay. Therefore, boundary of H of xi n, I am writing the same thing again, which is what I am writing here. Yeah. This is boundary of H of boundary of xi n. You remember there was a, in the definition of this one, there is a H of boundary of xi n. The boundary of this I have found out. Now I am finding boundary of H of xi n, okay? Boundary of H of xi n, by definition, it is gamma naught of the whole thing. So first you delete gamma naught, whatever is in the bracket will be written down there. C naught C1 Cn minus B naught Bn Bn minus H of boundary of xi n. And then minus gamma n you keep, and then take the boundary of the rest of them, boundary of whatever is inside. That is boundary of C naught C1 Cn minus boundary of B naught Bn Cn minus boundary of H of boundary of xi n. Okay, the boundary of H of boundary of xi n we have found out. Boundary of H of boundary of xi n is boundary of this minus this, which is just this factor. So whatever is in the bracket, it's just zero. So you get only the first line. The first one is eta 1 of xi n. Second one is eta naught of xi n minus H of boundary of xi n. Okay. You take this last term on the left hand side, then what you get is this formula. The formula for eta. Yeah, this is the formula we wanted. So this will be brought when you take this one, namely this last term here, take it on this side. So the construction of this prism operator is over. Okay, remember, once this is done, the homotopy axiom is completely proved. So let us go to the excision now. Okay, here we shall present a proof of the excision theorem. Recall that we have defined a subdivision chain map SD from C dot K to C dot of SD of K. SD of K was a subdivision, the barycentric subdivision of K, where K is a simplicial complex. Okay, this idea will be now completely generalized here. Okay, this was not all that great thing. This was used to prove Brouwer's Lefschetz fixed point theorem, but the idea is very good. So we are going to extend it to the entire singular chain complex now. Okay, so subdivision chain map at the singular chain complex level itself, and a chain homotopy D from SX to SX, okay, of this SD with the identity map. Okay, simultaneously these two things will be defined. Okay, so again, this will be done inductively. First of all, if tau is a zero chain, SD of tau, you take it as tau. That means each point is taken to itself. This was the case with SD also in the case of simplicial complex. Okay, all the vertices were taken to vertices. The extra vertices were somewhere taken. So that we don't have that trouble at all now. So it is in some way it is much simpler here. And d tau to be zero. Okay, you start with this. This is the starting hypothesis, an S naught level. Having defined SD and D on n minus 1 chains, we shall now define them on n chains. First, let xi n be the identity singular and simplex, just like we did it for the prism operator. Okay, on delta n, let us first define SD of xi n. SD of xi n, now you see, this is a game. So again, it is some kind of repeating it. Beta delta n, so there we get took the center gamma of this one, gamma n. Gamma n was what? It's beta delta n shifted to a half level. Okay, because there we are doing it x cross I. So here we are doing within x itself. So it's beta delta n extending SD of the boundary of xi n. So it's a cone construction over this one. Look at whatever is doing on the boundary of xi n, okay, say SD of that one is defined. You take beta n, extend it by beta n of xi n. This will be the definition of SD of xi n, okay. And D of xi n is going to be beta of delta n of SD of boundary of xi n minus D of boundary of xi n. Okay, see, this SD is common, is this bracket to all this bracket, SD of boundary of xi n max xi n minus D of boundary of xi n. So take SD of that. Okay, so beta of delta n is going to be that. Not very sure whether brackets are correct here. This bracket is correct. Let us see. d has to be n plus 1 chain, d of boundary of psi n. Okay, so let us go ahead with it. Now for any n simplex, sd of sigma will be sigma dot of that. Sigma dot is the chain map induced at the chain level. Okay, so sigma dot of sd of psi n. Okay, so this idea is similar to what we did in the homotopy theory. After defining for psi n, we take for arbitrary sigma, you take sigma dot of that, and d sigma equal to sigma dot of d of psi n. So sigma dot depends on denotes the homomorphism induced by sigma on the chain complexes. Okay, so then extend them linearly over all the chains by taking the summation. Summation ni sigma I sd of this one is summation of ni of sd of sigma I. And sd of sigma I is equal to sigma dot of this. So this also you can say it's sigma dot of this. Okay. Notice that once we define these maps on the universal singular simplex, namely psi n. Okay. Then the rest of the definition is forced on us by the functoriality. By functoriality, it has to be like that. So that helps us to define the whole thing. Just like in the proof of homotopy invariance, this is a typical example of what Vagnani does in such situations and worth noting down. So once again, I keep telling that if you know, if you have to do some existence theorems, construction and so on, you better understand how far it is free. How far, what is the free choice on your order? Once you see, for example, like in the existence of different solution of differential equation, there's a uniqueness part. The uniqueness part actually tells you what could be the map, what could be the solution. Okay, here is a case wherein, because it has to be like this, okay, because of functoriality, that helps us to define. Okay, you cut it down and define it for only for psi n, then you have done. Okay. To see that SD is a chain map means what? You have to commute with DABA. DABA composite SD of tau must be SD of tau of DABA of tau. This is what you have to do. Again, we can do it by induction. Okay. Induction on homogeneous elements of degree n, then namely tau is a chain, n chain. If n is 0, there is nothing to prove. There is no commutative diagram. So you have to start with n equal to 1 to n to 0. Okay. So you can assume that n equal to 0, it is done, because for minus 1 there are obviously 0 zeros here. Having proved this for n minus 1, we note that it is enough to consider the case, again, instead of arbitrary tau here, you just take for xi n, boundary of sd of xi n should be equal to sd of boundary of xi n. If you prove that, then again, by taking tau star of that, this formula will follow. So then we have boundary of sd of xi n is sd of xi n, SD of boundary of xi n, okay, minus beta delta n of boundary of SD of boundary of xi n. Okay, see, first take boundary of xi n, then SD of that, okay, then beta n you have to take, and then the whole thing minus this. Boundary of xi n has to be subtracted, and then you have the SD of that. SD of boundary of xi n is one first term here, minus beta delta n of SD of boundary of xi n. Okay, why? Because I have already verified SD is commutes with DABA on lower dimensional chains. So here I'm using that one. So SD comes out and DABA goes in. DABA is zero. So this part is zero. So what I left it is SD of boundary of psi n. ओके बाउंड्री ऑफ जब लाइन व्हाट इज बाउंड्री ओके सो डाबा डाबा इज जीरो इज ऑलवेज ट्रू एंड दिस डाबा कम्स आउट एंड एस टी गोस इनसाइड एस टी कम्स आउट और डाबा गोस इनसाइड बिकॉज एस टी वी हैव बाय इंडक्शन हाइपोथेसिस ओके ओके सिमिलरली नाउ आई हैव टू शो फाइनली दैट डी डाबा प्लस डाबा डी इज इक्वल टू एस डी माइनस आइडेंटिटी तो अगेन यू डू इट फॉर इंडक्शन बाय इंडक्शन एट डिग्री जीरो देर इज नो स्टेटमेंट एट डिग्री वन दिस फॉलोज ऑन द फैक्ट दैट डी नॉट हैज बीन चोजन टू बी जीरो सो सपोज वी हैव प्रूव्ड स्टेटमेंट फॉर एन माइनस टू चेन्स देन यू वॉन्ट टू प्रूव एन माइनस वन चेन एज अ कॉन्सिक्वेंस बाउंड्री ऑफ डी ऑफ डाबा का एन ओके बिल्कुल बाउंड्री डी प्लस डी बाउंड्री ऑफ जायन बिकॉज बाउंड्री ऑफ दिस पार्ट इज जीरो सो आई कैन एड एंड सब्ट्रैक्ट हियर ओके बट दिस इज नाउ एच डी माइनस आइडेंटिटी ऑफ बाउंड्री ऑफ जायन ओके सो दैट इज बाउंड्री ऑफ एच डी ऑफ जायन माइनस बाउंड्री ऑफ जायन सी हियर एच डी एंड बाउंड्री आई हैव इंटरचेंज ओके सो दिस इज बाउंड्री ऑफ एच डी ऑफ जायन माइनस जायन Okay, thus boundary of SD of xi n minus xi n minus D of boundary of xi n is zero. So if you take it on this side, boundary of something here, the boundary of SD of xi n minus xi n and this term comes here, la negative, the boundary of the whole thing is zero. Okay, therefore this was an elementary computation. Therefore now d daba plus daba d of xi n is d of daba of xi n first part then boundary of d xi n I have written down here by the definition so first term is d of boundary of xi n this term when you boundary of this one first beta delta n goes away what you are left with is the thing inside the bracket okay then minus beta xi n is there but then you have to take the boundary of the inside thing okay right so this will leave you just these two terms the rest of the terms just cancel away you can see the second and third term will be sd of xi n minus xi n will remain d of boundary of xi n d of boundary of xi n cancels out okay this whole thing will be zero so st of xi n minus xi n is left out so having proved this one let us just write down whatever we have done so that we can use it as a quoting a subdivision chain map sd and a chain homotopy d have the following property what are the properties first of all if you have singular simplicial k it will go inside s of sd of k this sd will automatically take care that we are doing it inside the Barysian subdivision of k if k is simplicial complex if it's not then we don't have to bother about it so it is generalized the old construction d of s of k is contained inside s of SD of K. So our new chain complex, our new SD, the subdivision chain map has the property that it preserves the simplicial maps, simplicial singular, the subcomplex are preserved. This defines a chain map and a chain homotopy at the subcomplex levels also. And further, second part is. SD induces a chain map on the quotient space also because on subcomplex it is there on S dot of mod K to SD of mod K, namely which is S dot of mod of SD of K. Okay, this is the subcomplex chain. This is the full chain complex. This is a simplicial one. And then you quotient out, you get just the simplicial chain complex. This is singular simplicial. This is simplicial chain complex. So all these things are now generalized, and one single SD gives you all of them when you respectively take the quotients and the sub. Okay. If tau from SD of K to K is a simplicial approximation to the identity map, then on the chain complex level, we have tau star composite SD equal to identity. Okay. We proved it much harder in the earlier case. Now this follows by because of the chain map. Okay. So let us stop here. And next time we shall prove the excision, basically excision and a few things which are left out. Thank you.